Hello everyone, it's Dr. David from DrRegisterNurse.com. I'm so excited about today because we are going to start a series reviewing the most common labs that you need to know as a nursing student for the NCLEX and as a nurse. Remember, always at the end of our videos, go to DrRegisterNurse.com for interactive quizzes, NCLEX questions, and an empowering blog. Our series today will start with a complete blood count, which is also known as the CBC. Make sure to watch. Hello everyone, it's Dr. David. So let's get started talking about the complete blood count, also known as the CBC. Any abnormality, either low or high, in a CBC is indicative of a problem. Usually, they may have some type of bleeding problem. So is there a hemorrhage that's happening with the patient? Where are they losing blood? Do they have a GI bleed? So when the patient comes in to you with these issues, the first thing you're going to look at, and the first thing actually that's going to be ordered, is a CBC. Do they have any anemia? So we're going to start talking about the hemoglobin and hematocrit. Do they have any type of infectious disease? So we're going to look at that white blood cell count. Also, we're going to look at the platelet count in case the patient has a coagulation disorder, because maybe they have a cut and they don't stop bleeding. So what's happening that the blood is not clotting? So we're going to look at all these things right now. But first, I want to let you know that when you're taking your nursing exams in school, the NCLEX, they're going to ask you lab values for sure. Okay, they're going to ask you about those labs. But the nice thing is that you're going to know what the abnormal is, because they're always going to go through extremes. So I'm going to use a potassium level. So usually in a lot of places, the potassium level can range between 3.3 to 5.3 or 3.5 to 5.5. Well, guess what? The NCLEX and your exams are going to ask you in the twos or in the sixes, because they know that those are very abnormal lab values, and you're going to be able to know that there is a problem. So don't go into these exams thinking that you have to figure it out, because in so many different places, they have different parameters. You're going to know, okay? So now let's take a closer look at the components of a CBC, or complete blood count. One of them is RBC, which are red blood cells, as well as hemoglobin and hematocrit. The red blood cell count, hemoglobin, and hematocrit each measure aspects of your red blood cells. The normal range for red blood cells should be between 4.5 to 5.5 trillion cells per liter. The hemoglobin and hematocrit for females and males are slightly different. For females, the hemoglobin should range between 12 to 16 grams per deciliter, and the hematocrit should be between 36 to 48%. For males, the hemoglobin should be between 14 and 18 grams per deciliter, and the hematocrit 40 to 54%. If the hematocrit is low, as well as the hemoglobin and red blood cell, this can be indicative of anemia. And do you know what anemia is? Well, anemia is a condition in which you lack enough healthy red blood cells in order to carry adequate oxygen to your body's tissues. As a nursing student, you should be aware of the symptoms of anemia, which include fatigue, weakness, shortness of breath. So you may see these symptoms in your patient, and also you may see a fluctuation in the patient's pulse ox. So instead of their pulse ox being greater than 95%, it may be lower. Now, a red blood cell count that's higher than normal, also called erythrocytosis, and a high hemoglobin as well as a high hematocrit level could point to an underlying medical condition called polycythemia vera, which is the opposite of anemia. In polycythemia vera, the bone marrow makes too many red blood cells. So this excess cells thicken your blood and it slows the flow, which is going to cause a major problem. Can you tell me what that problem is? Clotting. So they put the patient at risk of blood clots. So it's very important that you're always looking at your complete blood count in order to determine what is your next action as a nurse and as a nursing student. Now, let me give you a fun fact. If your patient is anemic and they need a blood transfusion, do you know how much one unit of blood will raise the hematocrit and the RBC count? Well, one unit of blood can raise the RBC count 1 gram per deciliter and the hematocrit by 3%. So it is super helpful. So always look at these numbers in order for you to determine if your patient may be one of those that will get a blood transfusion during their admission. Another component of your CBC are platelets. So platelets range from 150,000 to 450,000 platelets per microliter of blood. Having more than 450,000 platelets is a condition called thrombocytosis, and having less than 150,000 platelets is known as thrombocytopenia. So thrombocytopenia can be seen in patients with leukemia, severe bleeding, such as in a traumatic injury or extensive surgery. Now, when platelets are low, you may see bruises on your patient, unusual bleeding from a small cut, blood in their urine and stool, because you don't have enough platelets in order to clot. However, a high platelet count, thrombocytosis, can put the patient at risk for blood clots. And remember that these blood clots are formed because there are too many platelets, and it can lead to other complications such as a stroke or a heart attack. Another component of the complete blood count, or CBC, are white blood cells. So the range for the white blood cells are between 5,000 and 10,000. A low white blood cell count, otherwise known as leukopenia, may be caused by a medical condition such as an autoimmune disorder that destroys white blood cells, bone marrow problems, or cancer. And as a nursing student, you will have to take special precautions with patients that have a low white blood cell count, as they are at higher risk of infection. When your white blood cell count is above the normal range, it's also known as leukocytosis. It is frequently a sign of an inflammatory response, most commonly the result of an infection. High white blood cell counts can also have causes that aren't due to underlying disease. For example, if you've had recent surgery, and also some medications have side effects that can increase your white blood cell count. And stress is another one that can increase the white blood cell count, putting them above 10,000. So let's review. A complete blood count, CBC, includes your red blood cells, RBCs, and the normal value is 4.5 to 5.5. Hemoglobin and hematocrit differ between female and male. Female hemoglobin is 12 to 16 grams per deciliter. The hematocrit is 36 to 48. For male, the hemoglobin is 14 to 18 grams per deciliter and hematocrit between 40 to 54%. The platelet count goes from 150,000 to 450,000, and your white blood cell count is from 5,000 to 10,000. Now we're going to review what are those key labs that you will see in your nursing exams related to the complete blood count, and what particular nursing interventions you should put in place. Here's a picture of what blood cells components are. You have the platelets, the red blood cells, and the white blood cells, which have basophils, neutrophils, eosinophils, monocytes, and lymphocytes. All those are white blood cells. So when a patient has too many red blood cells, your priority is hydration, because remember, a patient with polycythemia vera, which is an increased red blood cell count, has an increased risk of venous thrombosis because their blood is more viscous. So you should maintain adequate hydration of your patient. Now let's move on to platelets. If your patient's platelet count is under 150,000, they're at high risk for injury related to increased potential for bleeding. So it is very important that you as a nurse or nursing student teach your patients how to decrease their risk for bleeding, as it is a critical nursing function. Some things that you can teach them is to avoid any type of contact sports or strenuous exercises that can cause injury. They should use a soft bristle toothbrush. That's very important. They need to check with their doctor before having any type of dental procedures. They need to take particular care when working with scissors, knives, or other sharp objects because they're at risk for bleeding. If a cut were to occur, make sure that you're educating them on how to properly clean the area and apply firm pressure with a clean cloth for at least 5 minutes in order to reduce the bleeding that will occur due to the cut. They should use an electric razor. This is very important for the NCLEX and for your nursing exams. An electric razor rather than a razor blade when the platelet count is low, because they can increase their risk for bleeding. Remember that, electric razor. If the patient is hospitalized, you as a nurse or nursing student should implement measures to prevent an accidental fall that may cause potentially fatal bleeding. And use of needles and any invasive procedure should be minimized when a patient's platelet count is under 150,000. Now let's talk about a decreased white blood cell count. This is super important for your exams. The nurse should carefully monitor the white blood cell count to watch for downward trends, and the patient should be carefully assessed for any signs and symptoms of infection. Patients with a neutrophil count under 2,000, as you can see, neutrophils are a part of white blood cells, they are high risk of developing serious infections, and if that neutrophil count goes under 500, they can develop life-threatening sepsis, which can be fatal to the patient. Therefore, patients need to be placed on reverse isolation. And what does this mean? This means that you as a nursing student or nurse needs to wear the proper personal protective equipment, PPE, prior to entering the room, because we are now protecting the patients from our germs due to their high risk of infection. Now let's talk about what you as a nurse or nursing student need to do for patients that have a decreased hemoglobin and hematocrit. You should carefully assess the patient with these low levels for his ability or her ability to tolerate physical activity. You should assess the extent of the patient's weakness and fatigue on exertion, because remember, they're going to feel short of breath, they're going to feel tired and weak, especially when they're trying to plan physical care activities. For example, if the patient needs to get a bath, they should do it following a rest period before ambulation. Another important thing regarding patients that have anemia, which is basically what a low hemoglobin hematocrit is that they have an alteration in their nutrition. The patient with a low hematocrit and hemoglobin needs increased amount of protein and iron in order to help the bone marrow produce additional red blood cells. You as the nurse or nursing student can encourage the patient to eat foods that are high in protein and iron, such as liver, egg yolk, beef, and dry foods such as prunes and apricots. When a patient is severely anemic, they may also take iron supplements to help them build their red blood cells. You as a nurse or nursing student can help the patient obtain maximum benefit by teaching when to take iron supplements and what substances interfere with iron absorption. This video was of great use to you. Make sure to like it, share it, and subscribe to this channel. I look forward to reading all of your messages down below. Make sure you put those comments or any questions that you may have. And make sure that you go into the Dr. Registered Nurse playlist and look at the previous videos that should help you with test taking strategies and a bunch of other content. Press the bell for notifications as to when I put up a video, and look forward to the next video in this series that's going to talk about BMP, or your basic metabolic count. Bye.